Da Fjord.
Okay.
It's four schlemmers, it's a shame. Okay. We're the first wide line on Da Fjord. Okay, Da Fjord, first wide line. Elo ikasho hokasho. What's difficult is it seems to be a stero. Beishamay and Beisilel. Beishamay omre minosin or lefne adorson. Lo yibienu. After you slaughter an animal, you're not permitted to put the hide where people walk. It's like the beginning of working the hide. Because the whole question is, because if you're not going to allow the person, the hide is going to deteriorate, a person's not going to do shechita. A person's not going to slaughter the animal. Nevertheless, he says, even though it will interfere with Simchas Yom Tov, we don't allow it. The soul says you can. Unless it has a Gzayis Boser. Because then why? So therefore we say that the Boser is not Muktza. The hide itself has no value, right? Unless it's a work tight. So therefore, you're not permitted to put it in a Dorson, you're not permitted to pick it up, it's Muktza. Unless it has a Gzayis Boser, because then we say that the hide is considered secondary, is tofel to the meat. Why? Because Beisil says, Yimatir sopush mchibosom. Because if you're not going to allow him to do it, he's not going to shecht. Because the person has any concern that the heart is going to deteriorate, he's going to take a financial loss, he's not going to do the shechita. So what's going to happen? It's going to interfere with Simchas Yom Tov. He's going to have meat. Amagab Simchas Yom Tov. So we say regarding Simchas Yom, Bishami luchumro, or Beisil lukulo, or Rimini, Hashorit chayvo. You have your emergencies, I have my emergencies. Yeah, okay. So, it seems to be a stero. Regarding Orlef Nei Adorson, Beishame is Lechumro, right? And Beisil is Lekula. Remini Hashor Chai Vop Yomtiv. Again, we have the same thing. Beishame says, if you have Deka notes, you can check. Beisil says not. So we see Beishame is Lekula. Regarding Simchas Yomtiv, Beisil is Lechumro. Amre Beelchum Mechlep Sashita. Again, same thing. You have to invert the opinions. Versus my dil melohi ad kan lukam bishami hosam el lehechodik or deka knows. So therefore, he holds that's sufficient. It's not mukta, and avol hech leka deka knows low. But if there's no deka knows, what is it? It's mukta. So you see, what does he hold by mukta? Mukta simchas yom tov doesn't override mukta. But it's interesting. Beishame holds that for the sake of having the meat available, what do? We allow you to shecht. Even though you're going to be putting yourself in a situation either mekalkel or malach shein tzvi gufa. Right? But if there's no deck of notes, we won't allow it. Why not? What does deck of notes do? Tosa said earlier, it's mukta.
Right.
So we say that Shechita, providing the food, overrides Mekalkel l'malach shein tzvi gufa, but it doesn't override what?
Right.
Doesn't mukta. Why, what difference does it make? Right? Now, let's understand something. According to Beis Shammai, I mean, even Beis Hillel agrees, once you shecht, if you have the deka notes, you could be Mekalkel, and you could what? And you could, whatever you learn, like Rashi Tosis. Tosis says, it's Mekalkel. Right? Rashi says, Mekalkel Tosa is Malach Shein Tzvi Gufa. Right?
Okay.
But once you do it, everybody agrees. For the sake of the mitzvah, you can do it. Right? There's no mitzvah, there's no Simchas Yom Tov any longer.
Right?
Right? Hillel says you can't enter into a chiyuv for the sake of Simchas Yom Tov.
Right.
You can't. Even though post facto you could,
right.
You could do it, doesn't make a difference. Beishami says no. You're allowed to do it because ultimately, you'll mimchaser.
Right.
With what? Because the mitzvah becomes the overriding factor.
Right.
The mitzvah allows you to be mekalkel. But the mitzvah will not allow you, if you don't have a deck of notes, it will not allow it. Why do we make the differentiation? Right? We make a differentiation. says very good with what the Marsho pointed out in the Gimel Amud Beis. When the Gemara had a question, quoted a Braisa, it says Sofik Beyo is Asura. Remember, we quoted a Braisa.
Good.
So Gemara asks, what's Sofik Beyo? Maybe Sofik Treifo. Gemara says, if you hold Pearson Noshrin, Sofik Drabon Lukula. If you hold, what's his name? Mashkin Shizobo, Sofik Drabon Lukula. You hold like Rav Nachman, but he, the Gemara, so Tosa said, why don't you ask a coin to Rav Nachman? Muktzah?
Because
Muktzah has the status of a Doraisa.
Right.
You see, we deal with Muktzah differently. So therefore, it's very good, right? But over here, we're saying, if you have Deka notes, you can. You could check. Why? Because Deka notes, what does it remove? The issue of Muktzah. So what am I only dealing with? Mekalkin Lachshin Zun Gufa. It's not a problem. Mux is like a Doraisa. We deal with Mux like a Doraisa.
Right.
Right? That you saw from the Gemara before.
Right.
Aval hech like a dos lo, inami atka lo kombi sil hoche lo dechozil mizka luyo. He holds it's not Mux because even in the unfinished state, the hide, even though it's moist, you could sit on it. So therefore, even doesn't have a kzayis boser attached to it, it's not Mux. Aval hosem lo, but over there not. You have no right to create a situation that has nothing with Simchas Yomtiv. Nothing with Simchas Yomtiv here. Right?
Okay.
The reason why we allowed you to put the Orlof Ne'adoros on, because he holds the hide is not Mukta.
Right.
Because you could sit on it.
Right.
Even though it's not a first quality hide, doesn't make a difference. Eli Kasha or Kasha. Mishami Omrim, Emisalkas HaTresim Yomtiv. Let's say you have this, like a kiosk. And the way they did it, it actually, you could dismantle it, and you set up a table, like the front, you know,
good,
like a kiosk. So the question is, are you permitted to remove the tracing, the walls, to create the table on Yom Tov? Not only could he say, could you open it,
but
you could even put it back. To open, you say, that's the open shop, that's Simchas Yom Tov. But to put it back, right, what's the simplest Yom Tov? That the Gemara says, because Vamat is so b'shem t'chilosom. Because if you're not going to allow him to put him back, he's not opening shop. So why do we allow him to open shop? Simchas Yom Tov.
So is that analogous?
It's a question of it's a question to sell food on Yom Tov. That they give, they'll pay afterwards. They'll pay afterwards, right? To provide food for people. So you have this closed kiosk. So he dismantles the kiosk, uses the front wall as a table. He displays the food. So even though it's stira, you're dismantling. You're not permitted to do this on Yom Tov, right? The Simchas, it's rabbinical. For Simchas Yom Tov, we allow it. Of course, it's considered a kli. The Gemara says, we hold a binyu stira b'kelim. It's not something which is attached to the ground. It's like a large box. It's temporary. It's just a... So we see for Simchas Yom Tov, we allow it, right? And yet, Bishami says, you're not permitted to do it. You're not permitted to. So we see Alma Gab Simchas Yom Tov Bishami Bisilul Mati Atlas Alma Gab Simchas Yom Bishami Bchumro Bisiluch Kula Ravino Simko Hashor Chay Vo Yom Tov Bishlam Bisham Bishami Lukasho Hosim Dike Deka Notes, as we said before, Hokaleka Deka Notes. It's a question of Stira Ela Bisilu Bisil Kasho Am Rabbi Yochum Chlev Sashita. Same. Atkes Mar says no. Atkel Kam Bisil Hosim Ela Mishum Dei Binyus Tiv Bekelim. Literally. Right? Aval Hosim Lo. But over there, because you're really doing nothing wrong, it's like Orban Lefnei Ador, so what am I doing? So what was the Havamina? I mean, we're talking about the Isidoraisa. It was really Stira, right? Well, that's not even consideration, Simchas Yom Tov. Before we say the essay, don't say the essay.
Good.
I mean, so what was the Havamina? Right? What was the Havamina? The Gemara says in Shabbos and Mishnah that if you have a candelabra that's made of parts and it falls apart, could you reconstruct it?
No.
So even though, no, it's made of parts, it's a kli. It's a kli. It was made already. It's not you make it for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
So it's made of parts. And halacha is the question, could you reconstruct it if it falls apart? So even though we hold in binyus tiv b'kelim, that's midoraisa. But there's certain situations on a rabbinical level, of course, there's a question of you may secure it,
right,
the gzeris. So a machmir. So over here we see it should be osam midrabanan, and we say it's permitted. So we see how that Simchas Yom Tov is to the end, like the Gemara understood, or the Fnei Adorso. Even though the hide is Muktzah,
right,
we allow you to do, to engage with it, despite the fact that it's what, that it's muktzah, because otherwise the man's not slaughtering the animal.
Right.
Right? So Mara says, no, it's not muktzah. That's Mara's answer. Here also, even though here, midrabon, it should be no sir to what, to dismantle it and put it back, but for simchas yom, it's not override. The answer is no. You're not doing anything wrong. Here, it's totally permitted.
Good.
Right? Because ain't bin yustir b'kelim. You can't say that there's a consideration between this and d'oraisa. If this d'oraisa, there's no way we can be moderate.
Right. So is this analogous to moving the ladder? If I don't move the ladder, I can't have simchas yom, I can't get the chicken.
That's where we started. That's where we started.
So I'm asking, is it a parallel?
Well, the Gemara made that parallel. Then the Gemara said it's not parallel, because there it's what it's Sulm Shel Shovach.
And here?
Here it's not. I mean, if you hold it's rabbinically, it's binyan or stira, you're not permitted to do it. So why is it permitted?
Right. So as we had the kiosk, as you were saying, I open it up, I put it together.
So what? So that's what? So what did the Gemara hold Mahav mean? Rabbinically, it is binyan stira. You're building, you're dismantling. Rabbinically, it's not permitted. So why is it permitted?
But we allow it for simchas yom tov.
Oh, so now we have a stira.
Good.
Now we
have okay.
It's interesting. I brought a deep from the Gemara. At one point, did you see that muktzah, we're more machin with muktzah, we deal with it like a d'oraisa. Correct?
Right.
Beisilo says, without tekanot, it's not even consideration. Even right. The Shami agrees. But yet, the Gemara held Nahavmi, or the Fnei Adorson, right, you permit it, putting the hide in the area where people walk, even if there's no meat attached to it, it's not a size bar, so you're permitted. It's muktzah. The Gemara held it was muktzah, Nahavmi. So Beisilo says, for the sake of Simchas Yom Tov, muktzah is permitted. Right? We're allowing a person to take a hide that has no value to put in the walking area, people should walk on it. Because otherwise the man's not going to shecht. Because if he's concerned, the hide's going to get damaged. Right? Or deteriorate, he's not shechting. So there shouldn't be any impediment. For Shechita, which we want to be in Simchas Yom Tov, we allow him. Because when people walk on it, that's the beginning of the working. You work the hide.
Oh, it's part of the process.
That's part of the process. But you beat the hide, you bang on it. So people walking on it, they walk on it.
Does he have some positive reason for they walk on it?
That's the positive value. It's not necessarily the right
side. To the hide.
To the hide.
But if he had to put it out, he's supposed to sit on it.
No. But the more held, it wasn't fit for sitting on. Because it's a newly fresh hide. It's moist. And it oozes all kinds of fluids. So Marahel originally, it's not fit for that. So it's literally, it's bona fide muktzah.
So the only reason to put it out is so people can draft it.
But the question, but how do you put it out? But how do you put it out? It's muktzah.
Yeah,
the answer is, because Simchas Yom Tov is an overriding factor. Because if you're not going to allow him to put it out, he's not going to shecht. Right? That was the Marah's question. See, Basil holds Simchas Yom Tov is l'kula. So how do I reconcile it with what? With that. Right? So why can't you shecht? But it's even more than, you don't, shouldn't even need a deck of notes, right? You only need the deck of notes for muktzah. But here you see, Simchas Yom Tov even writes muktzah. So the question is even more than. Beisilo says, you can't shecht because it's makalkum loch shen tzichut gufa. Right? That's the machlokes b'sham Beisilo. That's the reason we don't want you. To put yourself in the circumstance, you have to take the spade out of the ground, we don't want you to put yourself in that circumstance. But according to Beisilo, it's even more difficult. Even without the spade, we should allow you to shecht. Right? Because here the case, what the Gemara holds now, putting the hide before, to move the hide now, the hide is muktzah. And we say for the sake of Simchas Yom Tov, we allow it.
Unless you just say that's all the hide.
No. But it's a different question. It's a better question. It's a much stronger question.
Mm-hmm.
It's not only Simchas Yom Tov should permit Makalka and Lokshin Shil Gufa, this is a direct steer in muktzah. The hide is muktzah, the earth is muktzah.
It is or not.
Everybody agrees. If you don't have deck of notes, it's not even a consideration. Even if you shecht it, you can't
right.
do it.
Right.
Even post facto, you can't do it. If you don't have the spade in the earth, right? Even Beishami agrees you can't use the earth because it's muktzah. And here Beisil says, muktzah is not a problem. If it interferes with Simchas Yom Tov, you could do it. Good. It's not a problem. It's so elementary. It's not that. It's only because of the muktzah issue. It's muktzah. They still Shammai says because it's muktzah. Because you see, it said no because it says if it has a zayis basar, If you have a kazayis meat attached to the hide, even Bishami agrees you could do it. So it's so preliminary, it doesn't mean anything.
To the process,
so that means nothing. Because Bishami says if it has a kazayis buser attached to it, you could put the hide there. Because the hide is secondary to the buser. Right? So it doesn't have a status of muktzah. He still says, don't worry about it. So more held in the Havamina, even though it's muktzah, we allow it. Simchas Yomtiv. Right, that's what we're allowing it. And here, unless you have the deck of notes, we're not allowing you to slaughter. If you slaughter, no. So if you have post facto, it's understood right, because it's not Simchas Yomtiv anymore. Right? Once you slaughter, unless you have deck of notes, why should we allow you to do the mitzvah? For the sake of mitzvah, we're not going to allow you to do it. But over here, if we're not going to be able to allow you to slaughter, unless you could cover it, so what do you need a deck of notes? Even without a deck of notes. Let's say the mitzvah doesn't have a deck of notes. Didn't put a spade in the granulated sand. Everybody agrees you cannot slaughter. According to Beis Hillel, why can't you slaughter interferes with Simchas Yomtiv? Because the Machlokes Beis Shammai and Beis Hillel is we have a deck of notes.
I'm saying,
but it's a stronger question.
Right. But you still see the shovel in the ground.
You shouldn't need a shovel.
You shouldn't, on your question, but here, additionally.
According to Mars Teretz, it's very good.
Right.
It's not muktzah. The hide without kazayis is supposed to not muktzah, because factually somebody could sit on it. And there, if you wouldn't have the spade, you could have taken it because it's muktzah. That's exactly the reason. The spade, putting the spade in the earth means that earth that you can take out, that's pre-designated. But you have the other issues. You're creating a hole, right? Or the whatever, or makalkel, you're damaging the ground.
Presumably during the week when you shafted the animal, he would put the hide right there in the same place.
He'd do better than that. He'd do better than that. He'd start the tanning press. If you jumped, if you're not a little tanning, is in this doraisa.
So why does he have to put it beneath the trampoline? Why can't he just put it someplace else?
Because it's going to deteriorate by the time you jump this open, the hide's going to deteriorate, that it'll lose its value. That's the reason. During the week, he'll
eat. He has to start this part.
He has to start it now. Otherwise, it starts.
So there's limit to that logic. If it's an important element of the process, if you don't do it now, then it's going to deteriorate.
It's not Mabi. Like later we'll say, it's tanning, yeah.
He wouldn't do this. He'd only put the hide in.
We'll discuss later what about a person takes meat and he salts it over the hide. Do we allow it? Because salt is extracting. Salt extracts the moisture. That's part of the tanning process. Do we allow it? So the Gemara says, we allow it. Even though salt is going on the hide, because again, it's preliminary, it's not really. And the whole idea, it's nirikim abit. So since it appears as if you're doing the tanning process. But since he's so therefore, it's not seen as that. Even though it's haroma, it's like a subterfuge. Using a subterfuge to be able to, some salt should fall on it, doesn't make a difference. Well, since it's not obvious, that's what he's doing. Okay? Let's see, Rashi was before. Beis Hillel Matirim with the Hagos HaBachis in the parenthesis, in the margin. Beis Hillel allows you to what? To put the hide where people walk. Rashi, Lefnei HaDorson, Lo Yishtechenu B'Mokut Shrisas HaRaglayim, Shizel Tzorach Ibud. This is needed ultimately for the tanning process. This is Beis Shammai. Shemis Abed Al Yidei HaDriso, as a result of trampling on, walk on it, it's Misabed, it means it's getting worked. Beis Hillel Matirim, the Gemara held him because why the lo shori slay? Because if you're not going to allow him to do that, lo shorus, he's not going to slaughter. So Gemara says no, it has nothing to do with that. He holds the mizgalate that the hide, even in this unprocessed state, you could sit on it. Kate hoisa yishivosim shotchem begodim al gavi akarka v'nismochin v'yoshim al birkeim fufim. They would sit, you know, like Indian style, crossed legs, and they would lean on one another. They would lie on each other's knees. Tracing, Losses a chavona shalchanios shesogrin behem achalonis belaylo. They would close up the shops at night. Umesalkosam biyom nosan sulthneim sholchan aleim tavlin limko l'rabim. They would spread their wares on this door. Ubiyom to mutal ikach mechadvoni hamakir also, because you're not discussing, you know, money or the amounts. Uvach liyaskus chumekach, as long as he doesn't mention the cost of the purchase. Avlahasul lisko behem chazor vadeish lo tzorchi. Right? Because Sharin Lay Mishum Tchilos is saying, what do we allow you to put it back? Bishlom to open it, we allow with that Simchus Yomtiv. What do we allow you to put it back? The answer is, because you're not allowing him to put it back, he's not opening. This is called Mata Sofa Mishum Tchilos. We allow you to put it back, although putting it back is not with Simchus Yomtiv. Can come on, Alma Shimshim Siyom the Makalinon, Kasha Basil El the Kisu, it's how do we reconcile Basil that he says you're not permitted to slaughter unless you have the earth prepared. Hocha lekadek, no, it's clomi leka time latiro. Savi Yishmin Bikalin. Yeah. 1 second. Let's see the next mission. Bishame omrim lo yitol kein naneim mebojom. If you have chickens in a coop, you're not permitted to think of the chickens unless physically you take the chicken and you shake it to show that's the chicken he wants to use. Bishlomer omeid vomer zevizan inotel. You just verbally identify that chicken and that chicken. That's enough. Okay. Now the question is, if the chickens are omdim lachila, what do you need any designation? Right. If it's for egg laying. Okay, then you need a redesignation. If, let's say, during the week they're for egg laying. Right. So if you want to slaughter it, you have to designate it. Now we have known how much of a designation do you need, a physical act to undo what it was designated for, or verbally, that's enough. So Mara said that was the machlokus. How much do you need to undo the designation? Omer Avchon Barami machlokus b'rech rishon adina. Beishama and Beisil are arguing it's the first litter of chickens. Because the first litter, we'll see, that's the best quality to produce other chickens. Shamay Savri, Gazrin Dilosilim Luchi, since it's the first litter. So just by verbally identifying it, he may change his mind. What's going to be? He'll take the chicken and he'll end up not using it. So it comes out, he violated laws of Muktzah. Right? So Savri, Gazrin, there's no Gazir. Even though it's Brecha Rishona, once he makes up his mind he's going to slaughter it, he's going to follow through. So it's not going to turn out. Retroactively, it was Muktza. In a question. Since it's Berech Rishon, it has that special value, there's a chance he may change his mind. So what happens? He took it, and later he changes his mind that he wants it to be retained for Berech Rishon. So in that case, it's Muktza. A Berech Shnio, Dibri HaKol, Omid Vom Zev Zeni Tov, no tail. Sagyo. But if it's the second litter, it's after the first, there was second, everybody agrees, in Beisilel, Beishamayim, verbal designation is enough. Okay, before we go further,
why are we worried about him changing his mind?
Because it's Berech Rishona. Because since these chickens have special value to breed others, right? This is the first offspring of the chickens. They have greater potential to produce more quality offspring. So if they go and you go say, I will slaughter that tomorrow. You understand? It's not just slaughtering an ordinary chicken. Because by slaughtering that chicken, you're giving up the potential of this breeding, or whatever you want to use the term, another group of chickens. So the last moment he may change his mind. So it comes out here, he engaged with it, and it may turn out to be Mukta if he doesn't use it.
If it was a first generation, and says, I intend to slaughter it, I understand that. That allows him to slaughter it, or he wouldn't otherwise.
But Shammai says it's not enough. No, that's what Shammai says. You have to do a more overt act. When the more overt act you do, the less likely it is that he'll change his mind. Oh. That's what he's saying. Now, you go to the store, they ask you for a deposit. The greater deposit, the less likely you're walking away. You leave no deposit, for the slightest reason you're walking away. So therefore, the more you're committed, you're involved, or the more costly it is, you're not walking away so soon.
So it's really changing designations, like being committed to it.
Right. By doing that act, it's in the person's mind, I've done something so significant, he's not going to change his mind.
Mm-hmm.
But if it's just verbal, he said yes, he says no. You know, he can retract very easily. It's all based on the psychology of the person.
Okay.
That's what it is.
There's no problem to change his mind back. The issue intends to slaughter, picks up the chicken, and then decides I'm not going to slaughter the chicken.
The Gemara's saying there's a problem. Because then comes out, it retroactively comes out that chicken, he wanted
could
it during those brechrish, then it's booked up. Give you an example.
So we can't even hold it.
Yeah, so retroactively he held something that was mukta.
Oh, I see. He picks up, decides not to, then he...
Right. Exactly. I was thinking, you know, before we discussed the mukta, it's called mukta machmas chasaron kis. It's mukta because of its innate value, therefore it's considered a negation, like you buy building supplies. You don't use building supplies for firewood. So that, everybody agrees, even Reb Shimon, who's makel by mukta, the mukta machmas chasaron kis, because of the financial loss you would take to use it for something other than it was designated for, is mukta. Brecha Rishona, the first litter of chickens, is like mukta machmas chasaron kis. Because of its innate potential of value, he doesn't use it for anything else. So even Reb Shimon, this mukta, even Reb Shimon will agree with Brecha Rishona. Because this is a negation because of its innate value. Right? Just have to come for a minute. isn't because I'm concerned retroactively he touched muktzah. So that it's a little problem. Then you have seisis. Again, you see the stringency of muktzah.
It wasn't muktzah when he touched it.
No, but if later he changes his mind, since retroactively it was only designated if you were using it. It's like a conditional designation.
Okay.
Right? So then you have to say, see how strict muktzah is, that we treat it like a doraisa, because it's rabbinical, it's not the end of the world. Or maybe this. When originally the first litter, because of its innate value, it's not so easy, so that is because it's so fixed in its place, you have to undo that. Now what's considered undoing that designation? It's something where it's not possible to change his mind. Not because it's muktzah. What's considered something which is significant enough to change its designation? It has to be a designation for something else that he won't change his mind. So unless he takes hold of it, he hasn't undone it. So it's not because he'll engage in muktzah. That's not the issue, because he's engaged in muktzah.
But your example of the building materials, so much more valuable as building materials.
So therefore, you need something so overt and so significant to undo what it's locked into. This is like we discussed yesterday. A woman has a certain date on the calendar. She menstruates 3 days on that day. So that's called chazoka. That day is fixed, that's the day of her cycle. How many times do you have to pass that day to uproot that day? That's passing 3 times. Twice is not enough. Why? Because it's not significant enough to change it. Reich Rishona in a person's mind, the first litter of chickens, it's so valuable, unless if there's any chance he may change his mind, that's not sufficient to change its status. Right? So it's not because of muktzah. Not that way. So there's no proof to that. Okay, it's good.
But did we say it was egg, leg, and chicken? It was muktzah from the beginning, from the first...
Yeah, but here we're talking about before Yom Tov, he says, I will take that chicken to eat. So it's no, even if it's egg laying, it doesn't make a difference.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay, even though you designated it. So the question is, can you undo that designation?
Exactly. How much did you say? After more said, since there's a chance you may change your mind, that's not a sufficient undoing.
Good.
No,
amen.
Okay. Let's start over again. Amar Rav Chana Bar Ami, Machlokes Bivrech Rishonim. That the Bishamai holds that you have to physically take the bird and lift it and shake it, that's only Bivrech Rishonim. Rashi says, what's Bivrech Rishonim we do? Derech Magdila Yonim, Magadla Yon, people raise doves. Laniach Bivrech Rishonim, Kshalko Shona Liot Tzavis Lima. The reason is because the first chicken, doves that are hatched, the mother has a special affinity, closeness with them. So they want, that should be the companionship for the mother. Okay? There's a gzera, he may change his mind. We're not concerned. Therefore, verbal designation is enough, he's not going to change his mind. But it's the second litter. Dibri HaKol Omeid V'Omer Zevizani Notu. Sagi, even Meshami agrees to say, for this and this one I'm going to take, that's sufficient. Uveisil Lomali L'meim Zevizani Notu. It's a good question. What does he even have to identify which chicken? Leim Mikanani Notu L'mocha. He should say, before Yom Tov, of these chickens, I will take one of them tomorrow.
Okay.
Brech Rishona.
Good.
Which one, I don't know. Whichever one.
Right.
Well, stop. Question is not so simple. Now, why does Beis Shammai say that you have to physically take hold of it? Because it's Berech Rishona. So they have to undo the designation, you need something more significant. Beis Hillel says no, even Berech Rishona, by identifying it's enough. I will take A, B, C, and D. That's enough. But if he still holds, verbal is enough, let him say, from these chickens I will take tomorrow. What kind of question is that? Factually, it's Brech Rishon. It's the first, it's the most special chicken. Maybe if you identify each chicken, which one. So there, you're actually locking in with the chicken, although it's verbal. But if you have a thousand of these chickens I'm going to take tomorrow. Maybe if you don't know which one, that's not enough to undo it. Because it's a conscience. It's a conscious issue. So what's Mara's question? Because Mara right now is getting involved in Breira. Doing something later, does that reveal what your original intent was? But factually, whatever reveals, but factually, we're talking about undoing something.
Okay. It gives you a bigger problem.
No, there, the person is being very specific.
Yeah.
So even normally, let's say you hold a brayer.
But
you know what the class case of brayer is. The person has a barrel of wine, which is untithed. And he says, of this barrel, I will take out 2 pints tomorrow night. I'm designating, which one will be the 2 pints? To be seen tomorrow night. If you hold yesh brayer, you're permitted to drink the wine on Shabbos.
Right.
Even though those 2 pints weren't removed from the barrel. Doesn't make a difference. Because the act of tithing was done already. And which are the two? To be determined after Shabbos. So there it's just the basic. Was it a tithing? Was not a tithing? The two you will take out tomorrow night, are those the two?
Okay.
But here we're talking about something totally different. It's undoing a designation. So even if you hold brayer, but factually, since you didn't identify which one it is now, the designation hasn't been undone.
Right.
You know what I'm asking?
Right, but nothing compared to the barrel.
Yeah, but the barrel has nothing to do with undoing anything.
You can't.
Is it an act or is it not an act? Not knowing which two are coming out tomorrow night, 2 lugin that I will take on Motzei Shabbos, because he wants to drink the wine on Shabbos. Right? It has nothing to do with, is he seriously not serious? There, is it an act of tithing? It's not an act of tithing. Are you permitted to drink the wine? Here, what am I dealing with? Since it was designated not to be eaten because I need the chicks to be for companionship with the mother, how much do you need to undo it? Bishami says, physically, you have to be involved. He still says, identifying is enough. But maybe you have to identify it. The actual identifying, saying, from here I will take tomorrow. Maybe it's not enough. I think it's a good question.
Especially if there's a lot and then together you really can't.
Whatever it is.
Say, I want this one.
So what I'm thinking, you see, a chiddush over here, that if you hold yesh brayro, to be determined, and whatever's to be determined is what I originally meant, I will take 5 chickens out of this coop, 5 of the 1,000.
Good.
To be determined, okay?
Right.
Halachically speaking, it's as if you said, zev, zev, zev. If you hold yesh brayro, it's as if you said that. So if within halacha, that's considered, as if you said it, that's sufficient intent. You know, we're talking about halachic intent.
Okay.
You meet certain criteria.
Right.
As long as you meet the criteria, you've met the criteria.
Good.
So if identifying them is the equivalent, is sufficient to undo designation, yeah. So even if I said it in a general way, but if halachically it has the same status, it's undone.
So
if you hold yesh brayro. It's a chiddush.
Mm-hmm.
You have to meet halachic standard. If yesh brayer says B is the equivalent of A, it's the equivalent of A. Finished.
Right.
It's if I said it. Even though factually, initially he didn't know which ones it was going to be, it doesn't make a difference. But it's the equivalent of that. So if that's the case, it undoes the designation.
Mm-hmm.
It's a whole different understanding.
For tomorrow, so he understands the rest of it. But he picks the wrong people, black and white, white and black.
So the old yesh brayer.
So that it should throw that argument out the window.
But we'll get to the black and white. We don't want to have any black eyes now. We'll wait for that tomorrow. Okay. Okay. Let's see. Samar says. What's he have to say from this one in identity chicken? From here I will take. Maybe they'll say all the brayro. Right? They don't say to be determined is the equivalent of saying this and this and this one. But Tanan, we learned the Mishnah differently. Hames bebayis. Now, you have a corpse in the house. Okay? So the Torah says anything under the roof becomes contaminated with the corpse. V'yesh lo psochem harbei. Now, this is already on a rabbinic level. And it has many exits to leave. And you're going to take the mess out of one of the exits. Now, anything under the same roof with the mess is tameh. What about beyond the door? Beyond the door, you have kelim under the lintel. Okay? Under the lintel. Overhang. If the mess is not meant to go out that door, Are they okay? Right? That's what's discussing here. Hames beislop soch marbe kuna tvei. They're all tummy. We're talking about, we'll see, the door is closed. All the doors are closed. The kalim are on the other side of the door. You're not sure which doorway you're taking the mess out of. Kulam tameim. They're all tummy.
Okay.
Why? Because
there's nothing designated.
Because whichever door it would go out through the mess,
right.
When the mess goes under that overhang, okay. So the kalim under that overhang
right.
Are under the same overhang as the mess.
Okay.
So therefore it becomes contaminated. What about I didn't open any doors yet. I'm not sure which door it's going out of. So that means every door is a suffix. Which door is this mess going out of?
Okay.
Therefore all the psachim are tummy. Regardless of, right, because you're not sure.
Right.
Is it A, B, C, or D?
Right.
Are they tummy when the mess is in the house, and once it goes out with the one door, then whatever they didn't use would no longer?
No, we're saying. We'll see in a moment. We'll see. If they're all closed, niftach echad mehem. Let's say now you open one of the doors. Who tummy kula torim? It's tummy, which means let's say afterwards you opened it and now you put kalim under the overhang of or the other doors. So the kalim under the overhang through which you're going to take the mess is tummy, because the tumah is coming that direction.
Good.
The other doorways, the tumah is not going out that direction,
good.
Right? So therefore, those kalim are torim. Okay. Niftach echman hu tomei v'kul torim. Good.
It's overhang. There's no walls there. It's just
you don't need a
wall.
You know,
as long as there's no
wall. Right.
Under the overhang. So
right.
Small little opening. Kalim over here. Here would be tomei.
Yeah. It, not like it is an oil. That is an oil.
Like a porch or something.
Yeah. Lopsachim harbe, first, kulam psuchim, either they're all open or they're all closed right now. Kulam tmeim, kol hakem munochim b'chalal psuchim. All the kelim that are in that, under that overhang, tachas ovi atikra, under the thickness of the tikra, the roof, shel pesach tmeim, afi she'enu tachas gaga ma'al ala mes, although it's not on the roof where, the roof that goes over the mes, shkozu chachom tuma al mokum shu derach yitzir, lotze, Yitzias Atumo, Shesofa Lotze is Derek Sham. Bekane Nonu Yodim Bezi Yotzianu, Hilka Kun Tameim. Therefore, the rule Tomei. Niftach Echoman, Lacha Mises Hames, if the person dies, who Tomei, Ben Kalim, the Meikora, the Kalim which were there before they opened the door, Ben Kalim Sof, Hamuvon, Lobichutz, Kulin Torin, Divriako. The moda akol bikan labo bekelim muvoim the tochan memchutz vade b'diftach mapikle. Okay, stop here.